I'm still hoping that Nick would come in, but let's see. So what we will do is to discuss a bit about the confinement, because that's something you probably want to know about, you know, solve the last bit of the homework problem. And so can you see the slide?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So this is the slide I was shown at the very end of my class this morning. So we have derived the beta function, and we didn't go through every single step of calculation, but at least I outlined how you can go about and do that. And we found that the sort of gauge field contribution, the beta function, is negative, so that that would actually make the coupling constant to grow towards low energies. So we have solved the renormalization group equation and found this result. So if we have measured the size of the gauge coupling constant, energy scale mu, and then that would allow you to compute at what energy scale gauge coupling constant would blow up if you believe in the one loop renormalization group equation. And so the question is, what happens at this energy scale? And so one of the things we believe that would happen is the idea called confinement. So suppose you have some quark or matter field, which is coupled to the gauge field. And let's assume it's heavy for the moment, and we can come back and talk about when it's light. So suppose you have a heavy matter particle, which is coupled to the gauge field. So if you are talking about SUN gauge field, this may be an n-dimensional column vector. And if you also have another matter field, which belongs to the conjugate representation, and we call them n-bar. So n and n-bar together can form a gauge invariant. So if you use, for example, the notation with the upper and lower indices, this one may have low upper index, this one may have lower index. So some of the indices become a singlet, an invariant under the gauge transformation. So it is sort of the analog of the charge neutral atom in the case of electromagnetism. So charge plus and charge minus. And so in the case of SUN, that's the n-dimensional representation. We call the other one n-bar. And so that's the combination. And the idea is that when you actually try to pull them apart from each other, you may actually have this potential which rises linearly with distance. So this plot, I actually happen to have found a PhD thesis by somebody in Germany who have done this calculation for us. So this part of the potential is what have been computed by a numerical simulation using computer. So you literally put the gauge theory on the lattice and do the path integral numerically on a computer. And so we have talked about how you can actually do this, because you can put the fields on the lattice sites, and the link variables connecting lattice sites basically have the information about the gauge fields. And if you literally integrate over all of these matter fields and link variables, you can basically do the path integral on your computer. And that allows you to compute this potential energy that seems to rise linearly with the distance. But at the same time, when you go to short distances, short distance corresponds to high energies where coupling constant is small and you can rely on perturbation theory. So if you rely on perturbation theory, exchange of the gauge boson is the same thing as exchanging the photon in QED. So you would expect the potential to become basically Coulombic. So this is one of our Coulomb potential. So the actual potential should be then sort of a interpolation between two limits, where at short distance, you expect Coulomb potential. The only difference from the QED is that the strength of the Coulomb potential now also goes with these matrices, TA, TA. And so that's the only difference, but it's a Coulombic potential. At the same time, when you go to large distances, when coupling constant becomes very large, you actually expect the potential to grow linearly with the distance. So that's the idea, that the matter field in n-dimensional representation and another matter field in n-bar dimensional representation, and using the terminology in QCD in particle physics, let us call this quark, and let us call this anti-quark. So they are connected by the force due to the exchange of the gauge bosons in between, but this force is now getting very strong with this linear potential, namely that even if you try to separate this quark and anti-quark away from each other, you know, at whatever energy you start out with, you would eventually hit the potential barrier. So you can never, ever fully separate a quark from anti-quark. And so that's the idea of confinement. So you can never have a liberated quark or a liberated antiquark. They are eternally confined inside bound states. And if the potential is linear, as this plot suggests, then the force acting on the quark and antiquark is the gradient of this potential. And therefore, the force is constant. And the constant force is called alpha prime, that's the historic notation, or sometimes called string tension, because what is stretched between the quark and antiquark can be viewed sort of as a string connecting the two objects. And is there a plot on the slide? There is. You can't see it?
Ooh. I cannot.
What?
I cannot see it.
Oh, okay. I don't know what's going on. Let me stop sharing once. And do the sharing once again. How's that?
Now it's working.
Yeah.
And let me go full screen. Can you still see it?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I don't know what's wrong the last time. I'm doing the same thing again. So anyway, so what I was telling you is that at a short distance, the potential between quark and antiquark would be basically coulombic because the gauge coupling constant is weak. You can rely on perturbation theory. So exchanging the gauge boson once gives you the Coulomb potential. On the other hand, when you go to long distances and then you are facing the situation, the coupling constant becomes so big that you can't trust perturbation theory anymore. That's where the potential starts to behave linearly with the distance. And this is the behavior we call the string tension. So namely that the quark and antiquark behave as if there is actually a string connecting between them. And the energy of the string is proportional to the distance or length of the string. And that's why potential goes linear with it. So it seems that the slide is frozen again. Hmm.
Yeah, so, it seems like the upper side of the slide is gone.
Upper side of the slide is gone.
Yeah, we can only see the bottom two graphs.
Oh, really? Yeah. That's really bizarre. So if I don't go the full screen, can you actually see it?
Yeah.
So let me share it again. So this way you can see it?
Yeah.
Huh. Very, very strange. Is it because I have another window open in Keynote? Let me try it once again and tell me if you can see. So I am now showing the plot. Can you see it?
Yeah, now we can see it.
Yeah, now it's showing.
Oh, okay. So maybe having multiple windows is the cause of the problem. So let's hope this would work. So anyway, what I was trying to tell you is that when a quark and antiquark are confined with this linear potential, so that's the behavior as if there is actually a so linear object we call string connecting them. And the linear object string has a fixed tension so that the energy between them would be the tension alpha prime times the length of the string. So that's the sort of phenomenological description of the confinement. So linear potential is the same thing as having a string connecting quark and antiquark. So, once this happens, then you can easily see that there is a finite size connecting two objects. And if you have an object with a finite size, quantum mechanics always tells you that there is actually inverse size, giving you the uncertainty of momentum. So these things are actually rapidly moving about. And as a consequence, there is a kinetic energy inside the bound state, which basically is actually the mass of the bound state. So historically, string theory was used to try to explain the strong interaction, but they didn't literally mean these strings back then, right? No, they did. This was actually the string theory. And this, of course, eventually became the theory of quantum gravity at the end of the day. But initially, historically, the string theory was invented to describe literally this. And so that goes back to the action first written down by Nambu and Goto, which was meant to be really description of the string as a way of describing these bound states of quark and antiquarks. So then we are actually having this situation, which is actually one of the Millennium Prize problems of the Clay Mathematical Research Institute. And so the Clay Millennium Prize problems has a lot of sort of important problems in mathematics. And one of them is, for example, the Riemann conjecture on the zeta function. And the Poincaré conjecture was one of them, of course, which has been solved by now. So this is a list of major problems in mathematics. And one of the problems they list, and as a prize of $1 million, if we actually manage to solve this, is this question about Yang-Mills theory in a mass gap. So Yang-Mills theory is the non-Abelian gauge theory without matter fields for now. And the mass gap is the idea that if you have Yang-Mills theory, the theory doesn't have any dimensional full parameter, with coupling constants dimensionless. But somehow, the idea is that it actually develops a mass gap. So the lowest lying state would have a finite mass, which basically corresponds to the energy scale where coupling constants become infinite. And so can you prove that non-Abelian gauge theory really does lead to mass gap is the question they are posing for $1 million. So if you actually manage to solve that problem, you do get $1 million for that. So what is the puzzle here? Well, so I mentioned this idea of strings connecting quark and anti-quarks. And experimentally, in the strong interaction physics, you actually do see many, many of these bound states. And Berkeley is one of the places that discovered many of those using bubble chamber that was invented by Don Glaser here in Berkeley. And there was a Bevatron on the hill that also discovered many of these states. And so so these states do exist. And I got this table from Particle Data Group, and they have many different quantum numbers. And then I mean, one of the things that people did, actually started with Geoffrey Chu, again here in Berkeley, is to plot them in the following fashion. So here's the plot. The horizontal axis is the spin of these bound states, and the vertical axis is mass squared of all these bound states. And what you see is that they seem to line up sort of linearly, depending on what kind of quantum numbers you're looking at. And so this blue one corresponds to 0+, which means that there's isospin 0. And the G parity is a complicated definition I don't get into. And J is the spin of the bound state, the parity even, charge conjugation even. So these are the states which seem to line up on this linear line between spin and mass squared of the bound states. And similarly, for the other quantum numbers, the green ones also seem to line up well on this rather straight line. And it turns out that this is something you can understand based on the picture of the string. So any questions so far? Okay. So how do we understand this? So this is actually sort of semi-classical argument. Suppose you have a Hamiltonian of massless relativistic particle, so that kinetic energy is C times P, and potential energy that rises linearly with the distance. And so here is sort of the Bohr-Sommerfeld kind of argument, how to work out the energy levels of this Hamiltonian, and here we go. So if you have the angular momentum L, R times P is the orbital angular momentum, which is L times H bar. So the momentum can be then approximated by L times H bar over R. So I plug this in here, and then I minimize this expression with respect to R to find what is sort of the maximum probability for the distance between two objects. So I take the R derivative, set it to zero, and that tells me what R squared is. So looking at this expression, I bring R squared upstairs. Then balancing between these two, R then would be square root of L. I plug that back into this expression for the energy. And then, so this is the expression I just mentioned, R goes like square root of L. And then the energy goes like the square root of L. And energy of this bound state system is supposed to be the mass of the entire system. So here you see the mass goes like square root of L. Therefore, mass squared goes like the angular momentum. So the simple idea of this linear potential then gives you this slope where the mass squared is roughly speaking proportional to the angular momentum of the system. So this was the idea of string theory, namely that you have something that looks like an elastic string and whose energy is proportional to the length of the string. And the motion of the relativistic string then actually gives you this kind of relationship between the mass squared and the spin of the bound state objects. And of course, when the string picture, they didn't know that their quark and antiquark attached on the outside of the string, but that's not what we think what's happening here. So the idea here is that non-Navier gauge theory, once the string coupling constant becomes strong, starts to show this string-like behavior, where you have this potential energy between quark and antiquark that goes linearly with the distance between them. So this plot, called Chu Low plot, according to Geoffrey Chu in Berkeley, is the first demonstration that this kind of idea based on string and linear potential seems to actually make sense. Any questions about this stuff? And can you see the slides now, just to make sure?
Yep.
You can? Okay, good. All right, so then the question is, how do we actually figure out that the potential is linear using non-Navier gauge theory? And I told you already that perturbation theory doesn't work anymore, so we have to rely on some other methods. And what I'd like to actually explain to you now is what is called the strong coupling expansion. So instead of expanding in coupling constant G, we are trying to expand the theory in terms of 1 over G squared. So that's a strong coupling expansion. And this can be done when you formulate the theory on the lattice. And in order to do so, I need to do a little bit of preparation for it. So this is the way we have been writing down the Lagrangian for the gauge theory so far. The covariant derivative is the partial derivative minus I coupling constants times A mu, that's a matrix gauge field. And F mu nu also contains coupling constant this way. And this is how we have been writing the Lagrangian. It turns out that if you want to write the Lagrangian on the lattice instead, it's much better to scale the gauge field to absorb coupling constant in its definition. So once you do so, the covariant derivative doesn't have gauge coupling constant in it. But once you do so, then d mu d nu commutator, which is g times f mu nu, is now f mu nu itself without factor of g. So instead, what you have to do then is to write the kinetic term for the gauge field as trace ff over g squared. So this is just a result of this rescaling of the gauge field by factor of g now absorbed into the definition of the gauge field. So if you start with this Lagrangian instead, all you have to do is whenever you see gauge field, you put the factor of g in it. So then this covariant derivative now recovers the del mu minus iga mu. And if you do the scaling for the f mu nu starts with the gauge field. So this gains a factor of g. I have two factors of f. So I have get g squared from this. That cancels this denominator g squared. So I go back to the original form of the Lagrangian. So you can see that they are the same thing just by rescaling the definition of the gauge field. And that's a dummy variable integration anyway. So it turns out the way you actually write down the action on the lattice, and that's part of the homework part two problem you're working on, it uses this way of describing the gauge field. And this plaquette, what I talked about the last week, is the product of the link variable along the square on the lattice. And so that doesn't contain any factor of gauge coupling constant in it. So instead, what you'd like to do is to have this coefficient, and it's usually called beta in the lattice community because it looks like the Boltzmann weight, but this beta basically has a meaning of 1 over gauge coupling constant squared. So this plaquette gives you just FF, no factor of gauge coupling constant. The gauge coupling constant is there as 1 over g squared in front of this plaquette action. So this is the way we can describe the gauge field on the lattice. And this is the question actually Nick was asking me about by email. Did I answer your question now? Is he on? Oh no, he's not. Okay, hopefully he will watch it actually on a video later on. Anyway, so this is how we actually end up describing the gauge theory on the lattice. So what we have first is to think about the matter field. So let's say we're talking about this complex Klein-Gordon field, and the phi now comes in this n-dimensional column vector. And so this is a phi dagger. I should have written dagger instead of star. And the link variables connecting between them are between the neighboring sites to make sure that this combination is gauge invariant. So remember, phi transforms by ui on the lattice side I, phi j dagger transformed by uj dagger on the lattice side j, and this vji link variable would transforms by ui from the left, the right, and uj dagger from the left, so that this has the is now invariant under the gauge transformation. And so these first three terms end up being the kinetic term, so d mu phi squared, where d mu is covariant derivative if you properly expand this v in terms of the gauge field. And then in addition, you have this mass term. So let's assume that this particle is very heavy. So m times a is very large. And what we try to do is to create a bound state on the lattice by using phi, that's the creation operator of the particle, and phi, that's the creation operator of the antiparticle. So here you created a particle and antiparticle pair. But when you put the phi and phi star in it, by itself, this is not gauge invariant because this phi and this phi star transform differently because they are on a different space-time location. So what we have to do is to build a gauge invariant state by creating particle and antiparticle, is to, by connecting them by this link variable between them. So here, I created particle and antiparticle. Here, I'm going to annihilate particle and antiparticle. And the particle and antiparticle separate by distance L. So this is here where I created the bound state between particle and antiparticle. Then after time interval T, I'm going to annihilate this bound state. And again, when you annihilate particle and antiparticle, I have to properly connect the link variables so that this state is gauge invariant. So having created the bound state, letting evolve by time interval T, and bring it back to the vacuum at the end of the day, then this path integral over phi is supposed to give me the exponential minus energy of the system times time interval, because it's a Euclidean theory. So in Minkowski space, you get e to the minus iet. In Euclidean, you get e to the minus minus et, the exponential damping factor. And energy of the pair is supposed to give us this potential energy of the particle at a distance L. So if you manage to compute the path integral over this configuration, and that allows me to extract the potential energy of particle and antiparticle separated at distance L, evolving over the time interval T. Any questions about this? Is that okay?
Sorry, I think I'm, what are the arrows meant to represent again? Are those
the link variables?
The IJ, those are the Vs. Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. Okay.
And link variable has the direction to go from one lattice site to another lattice site. That's why I'm representing by arrows.
Okay.
Okay. So this is the way I can set things up so that I can start computing what the energy is when particle and antiparticle are separated by the distance L. And but in order to do so, I have to start first doing the path integral over the matter fields phi, and then do the path integral over also on the link variable v. And now that we are talking about a very massive particle, so the convenient thing to do is I rescale the matter field phi by a factor of n times a. A is the lattice constant. So that after rescaling, so I can write the new action in the following fashion. And I ignore this 2 relative to MA because I'm saying MA is very large, so 2 is negligible. So after doing rescaling, I have these two terms, which is now 1 over m squared a squared. And what used to be the mass term is now order 1. And this whole action is now in the exponent. And when you try to do the path integral over phi on each lattice site, the first thing you notice is that it's basically given by the Gaussian weight phi star phi to the extent that I ignore 1 over mass, which is very small now. So this is the main piece in the action. But if you do so, if you stick in only one factor of phi at the lattice site, this Gaussian integral just identically vanishes. So if I have phi here, the path integral over phi on this lattice site would give me zero. So to avoid getting zero, what I have to do then is to expand this action in the exponent to the leading order in one over mass so that this phi on the lattice site is compensated by phi star at the same lattice site coming from expanding this action from the exponent. So that means I have to take one power of phi star v phi so that this phi is now multiplied by phi star coming from expanding this action, connected to the link variable v to another phi on the neighboring lattice site. So that's the way I can get a non-zero path integral over phi at this lattice site. But having done that, now I have one factor phi here, which again vanishes upon the path integral over phi. And in order to avoid that, I need to get yet another factor of phi star v phi from the exponent, so that this phi at this lattice site is again accompanied by phi star at the same lattice site, so that the Gaussian integral doesn't vanish. And you can see you have to keep doing it. So I have another factor phi now at this lattice site, and to avoid getting zero, I put in yet another factor of phi star v phi. So this phi and phi star are now the same lattice site that survives this Gaussian integral. And fortunately, this phi I now found from the exponent is also accompanied by phi star when you annihilate the particle, antiparticle now, so that this phi and phi star also survives the Gaussian integral. So this side looks okay. But now you see you have to do the same thing on this right-hand side of this lattice as well. So I need to keep extracting phi star v phi from the exponent so that every phi is now accompanied by phi star at the same lattice site, so that it actually survives this Gaussian integral. And you can also try to do this by taking a longer route like this. But if you do so, you are using this action connecting two neighboring sites with more links. And each link pays you, costs you a power 1 over n squared. So longer route then will be suppressed by higher powers is 1 over m squared a squared. So the shortest distance path is the dominant contribution to the path integral over phi. And what you're seeing here is actually the very interesting fact that the field theory path integral on the lattice reduces to the particle path integral. So so the field theory path integral then actually contains the possibly infinite number of particle path integrals in it. And you're looking at the dominant contribution to it, which corresponds to a straight line. But as you can see, if you keep expanding this 1 over m squared a squared, you can have arbitrary path on the lattice going from anywhere to anywhere. And then closed loop always give you a finite contribution that survives the Gaussian integral. But the longer the path is, you have more suppression factor because of 1 over m squared a squared. And that corresponds to the weight of the particle path integral. So what you're seeing here is that field theory path integral really does reduce the particle path integral for this configuration. And the leading contribution, as we have discovered, corresponds to connecting phi and phi star with the least distance path. So this way, now I find a contribution that survives the path integral over phi on every lattice points. Then I move on to the path integral over the link variables next. So any questions about this argument based on the path integral over lattice points for the matter field?
So is it also possible for the loop to close on itself? Like for example?
Yes. Yeah. So let's say you have loop here. And so then what I can do is to take this. Then first I take this term for this link connecting phi I to phi I star here, and take another power of this action, taking phi I and phi I star there, and phi I, phi I star, phi I, phi I star, then every site has both phi and phi star on it. Therefore, that would survive this path integral over phi of the lattice points, every lattice point. And you end up with the lattice, and end result is 1 over m squared a squared times factor 4 for these four powers of link variables. Times also, I'm left with v's left, so I have the plaquette. And for every closed loop, you can find that successive expansion in this action will give you the phi and phi star accompanied on every side together for a closed path, and that will leave you the contribution to the path integral, which goes like this 1 of m squared a squared raised to the power, where the power is the number of links you have to go through for that path. And that literally corresponds to that particle path integral where the Boltzmann weight is the e to the minus the proper time of the how long the path goes in along the particle trajectory.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions here?
So the longer, if I just count by number of powers of m squared a squared, mm-hmm. the longer paths can also have combinatorial factors, right? Because there are many longer paths.
That's true.
So
yes.
For some actual numerical value, won't there be a phase transition where the longer paths become?
Yeah, so that's an excellent question. So in two-dimensional system, and that is basically what is supposed to happen, and which is called the Costa-Lethalis phase transition. So if your path is longer, the number of path for that length goes roughly like the L to some power. So the entropy associated with that is the log of it. So the number of configuration goes like the log L. Mm-hmm. And when you also have the system like a vortex and anti-vortex on two-dimensional system, then the potential energy between them is also log L. Mm-hmm. So if you have the potential energy that goes like log L, but number of configuration that also goes with log L, then at some point, then the entropy part might win because it's enhanced by the temperature. So in order to show this, let me switch to my iPad. So what I'm saying is that if you have, sometimes my Apple Pen doesn't work. Here you go. So if you have a system of a vortex, an anti-vortex, so this is actually sort of a field coming in like this, a field going out like this. We talked about this example when we talked about the Coulomb potential in two dimensions. Then energy of the system basically goes like log distance. But when you look at the free energy, that's energy minus TS. And then T and entropy goes like log L. And of course, this has to be accompanied by some kind of typical energy scale of the potential. So when T becomes bigger than V naught, then larger L wins. And that's when the vortex and anti-vortex start to separate, because the larger L wins, they want to be away from each other rather than close to each other. And that leads to the phase transition called Costa-Lethalis phase transition. So you're completely right, Max. So this is the way the phase transition can happen.
But in this case, when the potential will turn out to be linear, that will always win against the log.
So in this case, that does not happen. So So in this case, we are not expecting it.
Okay, I see.
On the other hand, the confinement is still believed to actually undergo a phase transition at the end of the day. So even when you have a confining non-Abelian gauge theory, it is expected that if you go to high enough temperature, then temperature is sort of similar to energy scale of the problem. So coupling constant starts to go down with the temperature. At the end of the day, it starts to become perturbative. And that is what is called a quark gluon plasma, that the quarks and antiquarks become liberated. They are no longer confined. And the experiment that actually tested the idea is the heavy ion collision. So if you smash big nucleus like lead, which has, you know, hundreds of nuclei in it, and if you smash them against each other at the Large Hadron Collider at very high energies, then these nuclei would melt. They become deconfined, liberated into a soup of quarks and gluons, and that seems to be what the experimental data indicate. So at high temperatures, we nonetheless do expect a phase transition, even though it's a different mechanism from this Costa-Lestaudis phase transition.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions at this stage? So I have basically shows you how you can do the path integral of the matter fields and pick up the leading contribution in 1 over m. So what I need to do next is to then perform the path integral over the link variables. So I have already taken care of the matter fields. So all of these phis now are integrated with a Gaussian weight already, so they will be gone.
Sorry,
but
I can't.
Once you integrate,
the slides? Can people see the slides? I can't.
Okay. Sorry about that. So somehow it keeps happening, huh? How's it now?
I can see it now.
Okay, good. And can you see the progression?
Yes.
Okay, good. So what I'm telling you now is that now I have told you how to do the path integral of phi. So because every phi and phi star are now paired on every lattice site, they all survive this Gaussian integrals. And after doing Gaussian integrals, phi and phi star are all gone. But what does remain is this V connecting the lattice sites, which came from this action. So this V now remains, together with Vs I had to stick in anyway to make this state gauge invariant. So these Vs I need to keep and then perform the integrals over Vs now. So this is the remaining path integral I'm supposed to do. So I'm supposed to integrate over all of the Vs for every link variable, together with the weight given by this Plaquette action, where the coefficient of the Plaquette action is supposed to be 1 over g squared. And here I'm not paying attention to what the constant factor goes in there. So this is, I'm regarding to be just 1 over g squared. I thought there was a factor of 6 or something, but I don't remember. And inside this path integral, I have this W, where W is what is called the Wilson loop, which corresponds to the product of these the link variables along the loop, which came from the matter field. So initial two link variables in this picture came from trying to create a particle-antiparticle pair out of the vacuum so that the particle and antiparticle connected by this link variable to make it a gauge invariant state. And these two link variables at the end of the time would correspond to annihilation operator for the particle and antiparticle, which were connected by the link variables again to make it a gauge invariant. And the link variables on the sides came from the bringing in the action for the matter field from the exponent. But at the end of the day, I had a product of all of these link variables along this loop and integration of the matter fields, basically sum of all indices. So it turns out that this product of the link variables are in a trace. So this combination of link variables along a loop in a trace is what is called the Wilson loop. So the idea is that when you do this path integral over the link variables with this, the action is the weight function, together with this Wilson loop sticked inside the path integral, that is supposed to give you e to the minus potential energy times the time interval. So this is the way you can read off the potential energy between the particle and antiparticle separated distance L using the path integral method. So now what I would do is finally this strong coupling expansion, 1 over g squared expansion. And as you can see, 1 over g squared is the coefficient in the exponent. So expanding this exponential in Taylor series is nothing but expansion in 1 over g squared. And you actually do need to do this because when you integrate over every the link variable here, sort of similar to what we have seen on the matter field, when you stick in link variable in the integral of the link variable, this vanishes. And to make it concrete, let's specialize this in the case of U1, which is what you're supposed to do in the homework problem. So link variables is e to the I theta, and theta connects two lattice sites, right? So this is the link variable itself. And integration over the link variable is integral over the angle. And what you see here is that if I integrate over the angle of the e to the I theta, this oscillates by a one full circle. So this cancels. So you don't get a contribution from this path integral. So whenever you have a link variable in this Wilson loop along this loop, this by itself gives you vanishing result. So again, you have to make use of this exponent. And using this exponent, you need to find a combination where this link variable is accompanied by the link variable V star, or link going the opposite direction, so that V times V star would survive the integral. So to make it concrete, I bring down this Plaquette action and put this Plaquette in there, so that what used to be the arrow pointing downwards is now accompanied by the arrow pointing upwards. And this blue times green now survives this integral over V. So this is how you can get a non-zero contribution to the path integral. And you also see that this green arrow also accompanies this blue arrow what I used to have. So this link is now already taken care of so that this survives the integral. But now I have new link, this green, that's not accompanied by the link going the other way. So this doesn't survive. So I have to bring down yet another factor of this Plaquette action to actually compensate that. So this way, I have to keep putting Plaquette action for every Plaquette inside this loop so that every link variable is accompanied by the link variable going the other direction so that V and V dagger together would survive the integral. So this is the way I can get a finite contribution to the path integral at the end of the day. But now what we have done is insert this Plaquette action for every Plaquette inside this Wilson loop. And every time you put in the Plaquette action, that costs you a factor 1 over g squared, which you regard to be a small number. So at the end of the day, the end result of this Wilson loop after the path integral will be 1 over g squared raised to the power of number of Plaquettes inside the loop. And number of Plaquettes inside the loop is nothing but this area length times time interval in the unit of the lattice constant a squared. So the exponent is LT over a squared. And this I can write as e to the minus LT a inverse squared times the log of g squared. So what you then found is that the Wilson loop after the path integral has this exponential behavior where I can read off the energy, potential energy as a function of distance by stripping off the time interval t, where potential energy goes linearly with distance L. So that's a demonstration of the confinement. So this way I derived the potential energy is indeed actually L, so that it goes linear with distance, and therefore this theory is actually confining. Okay, I stop here. Any questions about this?
So this argument makes it seem like this will come up for like any, this will happen for like any non-abelian gauge theory.
Yeah, this works for any non-abelian gauge theory, but in addition, it even works for abelian gauge theory. And that's what I'm asking you to do at the very last problem in the homework problem set.
Right.
So this strong coupling expansion then tells you that even abelian gauge theory would confine. And this clearly is puzzling. So the only way we can make sense out of it is the following. So I just wrote down the potential energy by looking at the exponent. So I just failed to actually show this. So this argument allows us to understand why the potential rises linearly with distance, and as a numerical simulation does reproduce. And we have done it now analytically that this is indeed the case. What do you expect in this high strong coupling expansion? But we also know in the case of abelian gauge theory, it is supposed to be free at long distances. So this is what is supposed to be happening. It's not proven, but this is the only way we can reconcile these two behaviors. So U1 theory on the lattice should have this ultraviolet fixed point. So here, beta function vanishes. And if you start with a coupling which is bigger than this, then beta function is negative and starts to growing in infrared, and theory would lead to confinement. But on the other hand, if you start with a theory which is weaker than this fixed point coupling, that will flow to a free theory in infrared, and that's the phase we see in perturbation theory. So this is the way we can reconcile what we see in the strong coupling expansion for the abelian gauge theory to what we know in perturbation theory in the continuum. So this is the reason why this strong coupling argument doesn't win me $1 million. So it looks like I have proven the confinement, but it doesn't earn me $1 million because I haven't shown you that this way of calculating things is in the same phase as the continuum theory. And if there is a UV fixed point, they are in different phases, and therefore I haven't proven it. So that's why this is still a remaining problem posed by the Clay Mathematical Institute. But nonetheless, this is the way you can observe this confinement behavior using by hand analytically, and that's why I'm asking you to do this use for the abelian gauge theory in a homework problem. And that's why I had to go through this in the discussion section today, that you know what I'm asking you to do. So any questions about this?
So somehow the group theory factors, like the size of the Casimirs and so on, it's supposed to control which side of this fixed point you end up on?
Yeah, so when I actually wrote down this Wilson loop, I have specified one particular matrix form for the link variable, which means that I have taken a particular representation to write V as a matrix. So if I choose different representation of the gauge group for the matter field, then this trace is taken in a different representation. So it may not be n-dimensional n by n matrix, but it may be in adjoint representation that will be n squared minus one dimensional representation. If you have a symmetric tensor, then n plus one over two dimensional representation. So for each matter field, the size of this V matrix will be different. And that in turn tells you how strong this attractive potential is that confines them into bound states, and which basically goes like the Casimir, if you actually work it out.
Okay. But is there a way to see, so I guess this is related to the question I was asking about the combinatorial factors for the loops, but how can we see that this beta function should have that the lattice theory should have this non-trivial UV fixed point?
Yeah, so that's something you can, again, simulate on the computer. And what you can do on the computer is by computing this kind of object by varying lattice spacings. And of course, physics is not supposed to change on a lattice spacing because it's just an artifact of the discretizing approximation of space-time. So if you compute certain physical quantity like Wilson loop, which is meant to be really the energy of the confined state, you try to change the lattice constant A, but at the same time change this 1 over G squared in order to keep physical quantity fixed. So you change the lattice constant, you do trial and error to compute the Wilson loop with varying coupling constant, and trying to adjust the coupling constant in such a way that the Wilson loop can come out the same as the previous choice of the lattice constant. And that's the way you can then plot the size of the coupling constant as a function of the lattice constant in order to keep physics fixed. And that is actually numerical computational beta function on the lattice. And if you do that, you should be able to find that the theory is indeed asymptotically free with a negative beta function for non-abelian case. And for abelian case, you should be able to do the same thing, but I simply have not seen this kind of analysis demonstrating UV fixed point from the lattice calculation. It might exist, it's just that I may not be familiar with the literature enough, but I just haven't seen it, so that's why I don't know.
Okay, but I guess, so just a couple slides ago, you convinced me that, my question is, what is the mechanism for the phase transition if it's not driven by the log L of the loop.
Right. So in this case, yeah. So in this case, the coupling constant becomes weaker as you go to a higher temperature. So going to higher temperature, roughly speaking, the same thing as going to higher energies. And then at high energies, negative beta function would make the coupling constant weaker. And once the coupling constant becomes weak enough, then it no longer confines, and the quarks and gluons would liberate out of the bound states. So that's the intuitive picture.
Okay. Yeah, maybe. So, but even if it's really weak, oh, I guess the point is that at some point this 1 over g squared expansion isn't good.
That's right, right.
The whole starting point's bad. Mm-hmm. Okay, I understand.
Right. So this is really true only in the strong coupling limit. Okay, so I hope you got the idea what the homework problem was about. And the last slide is just in case you want to know how exactly the integral over the matrices are done. And this is mathematically what is called the Haar measure. Here's one example of it in the case of rotation matrix. And the Haar measure is actually given by this expression, and integration over the angles 2, 2, 3, and 1, 2. But for the angle in between, you are supposed to integrate over sine of theta 1, 3. And this is unique up to normalization from the requirement that the measure is invariant under the multiplication by a matrix element from the right or also from the left. And this invariance tells you the measure is actually unique. That is what is called the Haar measure. And you can verify by sticking in each of these matrix elements into this integration measure. And then you can observe that DO of O indeed vanishes. And that's the statement I have used when I told you on this slide that I'm supposed to stick in this Plaquette action to make sure that the Wilson loop integral would survive this path integral. Okay, so that's what I want to tell you. And I hope it's clear. If you have any further questions, I'd be happy to answer them. No? Okay, so if there are no further questions, I'm going to actually stop here. And I will post this video also on the B courses and the syllabus, so you can actually go back and look at the video if some of the parts of the discussion didn't make sense to you. And hopefully that is sufficient for you to be able to actually do the last bit of the homework problem. And if you have any further questions, you can also email me too. All right, so have a good weekend and stay healthy and safe.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.